So, hello friends. So today we will discuss with the chapter 10, disaster management. So here you can see some of the headlines. Okay. So after you pause the video if you want to read them, or else we'll continue. So, can you tell? One, is it possible to prevent the loss of light caused by lightning? Answer is yes. Two, what can be done to prevent the buns on a farm getting washed away in the rainy season? You look at it. And three, why do we experience water scarcity? So, okay. So we have dealt with two types of disease, namely man-made and natural disasters. So in the two items, the news item you see above, try to categorize them into man-made or natural disasters. Okay, but often that happens that natural disasters are actually aggravated, that is, their effect is amplified by man. So as they say, natural and man-made disasters are related to each other. Okay, as I say, natural disasters such as famine, lightning strikes, cloudburst, storms occur due to changes in the weather. There is a possibility of loss of life and damage to property in such natural calamities. Now, naturally, we humans cannot control the weather. So natural disasters such as famine, lightning strikes and other such disasters will continue to happen. First, we come to famine. Okay, what is famine? The condition that arises, how to define it, due to long-term and severe scarcity of food, grains and water is called famine. So basically, what is famine? There is no food. Famines can be very severe. This was actually, if you want to Google how severe a famine can be, just Google Bengal famine of 1942. This was a really, really severe famine, and actually some of the people, the British government, are hated because they allowed that to happen. Okay, and it was a man-made, it's a traditional case of man-made famines. Okay, I'll just give a bit introduction. So in 1942, World War II was going on. So what happens is, in order to feed their troops, the Britishers diverted the food grains from India to their troops. Due to that, West Bengal was severely affected, because actually there was enough food grains was produced, but it wasn't available, okay? And people died due to hunger. And there have been many such famines recorded in history. But for India, this particular famine is the most severe one in all the records. Although, as they say, the main cause of famine is natural phenomenon, yet a famine is created by some human activities. Okay, I just gave you how the Britishers caused Bengal famine of 1942. Okay, now come causes of famines. Mind it, the natural ones. Drought, heavy rains and flood. Again, as droughts happen, so plants don't get water, they dry up and there are no food grains. Heavy rains and flood, they wash away the plants, and again there is no food grain. Crops getting washed away or damaged in the flood. Environmental changes such as temperature changes. Now let me give an example of previous year. What happened in Punjab, or in for that matter most of the India, the April, in March there is standing crops, and in April the crops are sown. So what happened? A hailstorm occurred in the whole of the North India, including Punjab, and that destroyed much of the standing crops. Though that didn't result in famine, but if these cases continue to occur, it might be. Storms, very common in Odisha, which is very frequently affected by cyclones. Cold waves or fog, damage of crops by animals like mice and rats. Okay, this we have more or less able to contain. Attack of pests, locust or disease of crops. Locusts are the most severe of any pest you can get. Okay? Basically, they say, as it's a tradition, that one of the when you see a pack of locusts coming, create as much noise as possible to scare them away. Though, technically, as they come, they destroy every other crop in its wake and leave behind plain destruction. Natural calamity like earthquake, etc., some of the natural causes of famine. Now, what is the man-made war? Like I say, it was the World War II, internal unrest, for example, Civil War of United States, it resulted in famine, absence of transport routes. Okay, for example, most of the cities like Mumbai, Pune, Delhi, they receive their grains from rural areas. If there is no transport, then effectively, whole of the cities will die of hunger. Uncontrolled population growth, etc. Now, what happened? That famines, as I said, you can find a lot of examples of famine in history. So, what to do? So, what did Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj and Chhatrapati Shahuji Maharaj did? To implement this, they built various other water arrangements. Such arrangements you can find even in the Rajput states of Rajasthan, where it rains very less. So, what they do is they have an arrangements to store water. Similarly, some parts of Maharashtra are too prone to that. So, the two kings took care of that. Their water supply and water storage schemes are ideal even in today's circumstances. Ideally, they should be conserved because the older people, they knew how to conserve water. But nowadays, most of these traditions have been forgotten and this resulted in water storage. You can look at Bengaluru. It had a lot of lakes to supply water. But now, water is practically of no use in Bengaluru. Mind it, these are not droughts, but they may result in it. Okay? You can too make a scheme like this to face future crisis and disaster, which will be of use not only in your own life future, but society in large. Okay, so what? Malik Ambar implemented a canal scheme for drinking water in Aurangabad. Okay, you can see about that. Now coming back to point, there are records of loss of life caused by severe famine in parts across the world. Naturally, since Asia has the biggest area, it is has the largest cases of droughts. The majority of famine occurred in drought-prone and flood-affected regions. Okay, the famine had affected India and China. China is one of the countries that had suffered the worst famines in history. I don't remember the year correctly, but I think that was the Chinese famine of 1986 or maybe it was 76. I don't remember that clearly. So, as they say, are we responsible for famine? Naturally. So, point one, this is what I'm raising. Water shortage is increasing as the balance between rainfall and population is disturbed. Okay, we will discuss it in every point. Two, there has been a very high rise in the production of food grains as a result of green revolution. The balance of environment has been lost due to use of chemical fertilizer, pesticides and weedicides, unlimited lifting of water, erosion of land and misuse of water. What happened is ideally the cities have a lot of people concentrated at one place. So what happens, even if there is water, there is water for say 10 people and about 50 people are settled, then this creates water shortages. This is the point first, because population is increasing and water sources, they still support. For example, I say a city had 5 people and water sources had for 10. So not an issue. Okay, everything was good. It increased to 11 people. It was managed. But then it increased to 51 and then to 100. Now that starts create water problems. And two, due to the use of chemical fertilizers, pesticides and weedicides, a lot of cultivated good land which can give crops has been destroyed. Okay, three, unlimited lifting of water. This is especially prevalent for water rich states who have lifted their water so much that the groundwater has now depleted. Fourth, erosion of land. This generally happens over a period of time, so there has been no case studies as such. Fifth, misuse of water. you know, when you put too much water in soil, the soil starts to salinate. And when you take too much water, when soil salinates, then it creates crop issues. So what we do? So this I'm reading a box. This box. So what we do? Planned usage of water and reuse of water. To give an example of point one, suppose you cooked rice. So what you do is you can, it's really good for skin. So you can put it. Two, proper planting of water conservation and harvesting at local level. If the building has a good enough and wide roof, you can put in water harvesting and don't unnecessarily allow the taps to flow. Three, large-scale plantation of trees and prevention of deforestation. Okay, this is actually what will happen, but will be a good to avoid droughts. Fourth, making appropriate changes in plans, taking into account the weather forecast. So basically, it's not like that it's going to rain, so you organize a function outside, because that will result in waste of food grains. Okay. So now coming back to point, cloudbursts. Okay, cloudbursts are fairly uncommon in the plains, but when it comes to hills, they are fairly common. Okay, so what happens is, suppose this is a cloud, okay, I'll take some different color for cloud, let's make it a mountain here. This is a mountain, and this is a cloud. What happens sometimes is, mountains, if they're very high, for example, the Himalayan ranges, they do not allow the clouds to cross from this side to another. And sometimes clouds are actually full of water. So what happens is, the pressure in them increases so much that actually it rains, they tend to release their moisture in a rather sudden way. This results in cloudbursts. This is one of the explanation. The other much detailed explanation is given in the book here. Okay, sometimes the water coming down from the red cloud does not reach the land in the form of rain. Okay, it's raining, but it's not reaching the land. Instead, due to very high temperature near the land, it vaporizes and goes back into the clouds. Now, one I explained is a valid explanation, and there are hills, or for that matter, mountains, not hills, even that, mountains so tall that they can stop the clouds. In India, Vindhya Parvat or Aravali Hills, they are not at that much height to stop water. So, just to stop clouds, I'm sorry. Only Himalaya has that range to stop the clouds. But in case of if it's very hot, so what happens is the water, as soon as it's land in mid-air, is vaporized. Now what happens is the cloud is trying, this is a cloud, it's trying to release water, but instead of water being released, it's again filled with water. And this cycle repeats itself, and what happens is ultimately the clouds burst away and a lot of water is poured over a very small area. This is known as cloudburst. The example given here are the Ladakh on 6 August 2010 and Mumbai on 26 August 2005. Both of them explaining one cases. So what they say, on that day it rained about 950 mm, that is 35 inches in 8 to 10 hours. So just give you an idea from where I come from, that is Delhi, it rains approximately 75 mm in 3 months. So now you have an idea about how much is the rain. It's 950 mm. Okay. So now we come to floods. Floods are almost an yearly occurrence in some years. Assam is one of the worst places affected by floods because of the Brahmaputra River. Brahmaputra River is really prone to floods. Okay. So what we do in case of floods? Construction of small dam in mountainous regions so that they hold the water and it does not spread to other places. Two, construction of percolation tank to put that water into the soil. 3, making riverbeds flat. 4, cultivation of new forest. This is actually really good because forests hold the soil and allow. 5, connecting rivers. Often it happens is that as one river is dry, the other is flooded. So by connecting the river, we can avoid the floods. One of the severe effect of the floods was the Chennai water floods. This was really, really bad. Okay, now it comes to lightning. Now, in the chapter static electricity, we saw how lightning is generated. Now, we will see how to protect ourselves from it. Okay, so a bit of good facts to know. Lightning strike opens ground maximum time. Okay, the reason might not be known, but this is what happens mostly. So what happens is, one line I would like to point out, a study of places struck with lightning show that it happens more on open ground than under a tree or near water. Mishaps have occurred most when a person is at a high place or near a tall object, because as we see, they tend to attract light. Now, wonderful thing to know that actually lightning rarely strikes. For that matter, I have never seen a lightning strike near the ground. Okay? Only 5% of it reaches the ground. That is super rare stat, if you ask me. Lightning can be generated between one cloud. Okay, basically these internal charges in the cloud, they generate lightning. Between two clouds, a very typical scenario. Or between a cloud and a ground. Cloud and a ground. About 40 lightning strike occur per second in the atmosphere. The temperature is higher than that of the sun. Okay. This is actually what makes a lightning dangerous in the high sky. So, now let's come to the precautions. What should you take? 1. Do not stand on open ground or below the tree. So, what you do is, this is a cloud, this is the ground, lightning would strike it here. Because as we explained, static electricity, it generates opposite charges. If it is negatively charged, this generates positively charged. And different case of a tree, then good luck, because the lightning would induce high charges and will be go to the ground through this. So don't stand on open ground or below a tree. Do not stand near a high location, and this is a highly idiotic thing if one does that, climb a tree. Okay? And high location because again, as I said, the charges induced are higher because the distance is less. Do not stand near an electric pole, a telephone pole, a tower, etc. One word for it, because they're made up of metal. And as you will see or you may have seen, metals are really, really good electricity conductors. Okay, so what happens is, this is a metal pole, the lightning strikes and the whole metal conducts it to the ground. So never stand on near a metal. Do not lead on wire fences around a farm, a compound, a garden or a house. Similarly, wired fences, again, because the wires are made of metals and they really tend to conduct. 4, if you're on a two-wheeler, a bicycle, a tractor or a boat, get off immediately and go to a safe place. Basically, any open place is an issue for you. Find shelter somewhere. Because generally, if you are on any two-wheeler or any such vehicle, chances are that you are on an open road. So try to find shelter as soon as possible. 5, do not gather all together in one place. Okay, unless that's a closed shed, then it's fine. But in open space, a serious no. Take care to keep a distance of 15 feet between any two persons. Okay, because if there are chances that if one person gets a shock, the other person might get a shock. 7, do not use in plugged electrical appliances. Okay, main thing is because when the lightning strikes, the high charge tend to affect the electronic charges first. Do not use a mobile or telephone, because again, the electricity disturbs the signals of mobiles. 8, stand on dry wood, plastic sheet, sack or jute cloth or dry leaves. Basically any electric insulator. Okay. Keep your feet together, support yourself on the soles of your feet, placing your hand and knees and crouch low. This is a position basically that has been proven to reduce the impact of lightning on the person. Okay. 10th, swimmers or fishermen should come out of the water. Yep. Water and lightning, these two don't go together, and it's a really bad idea to be in water when there is a lightning strike, because again, as we have seen, water conducts electricity. 11th, a pakka house is the safest place. Find out if there's a lightning conductor on any tall building near your house. If it is there, you should go there if feasible. Okay. 5th, volcano. Now, luckily in India, we have only one volcano, and that too in the remote Andaman and Nicobar Islands. So, let's discuss about volcanoes first. A volcano is a natural event or phenomenon. Okay. The interior of the earth is very hot. Movement of substances continuously occur from interior to the surface of earth. Okay, basically if you have learned the structure of earth, this is crust, this is mantle, and this is core. The mantle is continuously generating heat and giving it to the crust. Okay, basically then turn, if you haven't learned it, just take that there is a near inside the earth, there is some phenomenon happening which generates some substances. Okay. As a result, sometimes the solid, liquid and gaseous substances below the earth crust are pushed towards the crust. Okay. That when the internal all this thing is being generated, so now to find a vent, they come to the surface. When these things come out of the earth atmosphere in eruption and start flowing, it is called a volcano. Basically, when this kind of eruption takes place, it need not be as dramatic as the one shown here. Okay. 1. What are the effects of volcano? One thing, as they say, the chemical substances such as lava, vapor, hot mud, sulfur, etc. get collected on the surface of the earth, and thereby mountains and hills are created. That is a kind of a good thing, because some of the islands we know are volcanic islands. Basically, they were formed by a volcanic eruption. Okay. 2. The atmosphere gets polluted due to ash and gases ejected by the volcano. This is an actual, not actually a good thing, to be honest, because and if you remember, I think that was good 5 to 6 years back, that a volcano in Iceland erupted, and as a result, it disturbed all the flight operations. 3. Often it rains as a result of volcanic eruption. Okay, I don't know the reason for that, but yeah, this happens. 4. Temperature rises due to hot gas. This is self-explanatory. 5. Forests and settlements get buried under the hot mud. This is what rarely happens. For example, when this volcano burst, this material goes down everywhere, and wherever it goes, it takes down everything in its path. Be it houses, be it forests, be it roads, be it everything. If you see about the Fukushima disaster, Google about Fukushima disaster. Okay, that was more of a tsunami-induced earthquake. Okay, maybe a wrong example to give. But if you see about volcanic eruptions, they are really, really bad. And often, you can easily find some videos on YouTube. Okay. Volcanoes erupt in sea as they do on land. Pacific Ocean has actually a string of volcanoes. The same substances that come out during the eruption of a volcano on the land are ejected due to the eruption of volcano in sea. Now, as I said, some islands are created due to eruption of volcanoes in the sea. Some of them are created by volcanoes. Now, one thing is, we cannot control when the volcano will erupt. It is beyond our control. So what we can do is, it is possible to predict an eruption and to take immediate steps. Now, you cannot precisely predict at this hour, this minute, this will burst. But yes, you can, basic studying on when it was last burst, you can actually see that, okay, suppose this burst every 200 years. And right now it has been 210 years since it last burst. So it can burst any time now. One of the way of doing analysis. Okay, so you cannot precisely predict that it will burst at this hour, but yes, you can predict this. Oh, okay, yeah, it can happen anytime. Now, sixth, tsunami. Now, what happened is that earthquake happens. What happened? Okay, let me go a little more detail. Suppose these are the two plates on the sea. Okay, now if you have studied that the earth is made up of tectonic plates. If you haven't studied, that's not much of an issue. Imagine just two plates, when they collide, this results in an earthquake. And when this is the sea, what happens is, as the two plates move, they displace a lot of water. A lot of water is moved. So now what happened is, as the water is moved, this has really high energy. So now coming back to point, I'm reading this. If an earthquake occurs at the bottom of the ocean, the energy released pushes the water upwards, as I said. As a result, a peculiar type of waves are formed. Mind it, these waves cannot be seen on the sea. But if someone is in the middle of the sea, he won't have an idea that an earthquake has happened under the sea. Because the thing, one thing is, this is the plate, there is a lot of water around it. Okay. An impact can be taken by surrounding water. Basically, everything is taken by the water. So at max, a ship will feel a bit of disturbance if it is inside the deep seas. It won't feel much difference. Okay. Now, as I say, these waves are not near, very high near the source. Okay, as I say, if you are in the deep sea, you won't feel much. But they start spreading very fast to long distances. So they are not growing tall, but this disturbance they are very, very fast. So what they do is, as I say, the velocity of wave is 800 to 900 kilometers per hour. Okay, it's really, really high. When they reach the coastal area, the velocity is reduced. Okay, good thing, velocity is reduced. But their height is found to have increased tremendously, even up to 30 meters. What happens, in a bit of detail if I explain, here in the ocean, the lot of water was there to absorb this impact. But now, let me do an example for coast. Okay, brown color for land. As the water comes near the coast, now the deep sea is really deep. Not to scale at, it's sometimes very deep, like 2 kilometer deep, and by chance this is rather shallow. What happens is, the water which was coming, the water which was absorbing the impact, is no longer there, nearer to the land. So what happens is, it releases in the form of height. So what happens is, that is what is called tsunami. Such waves generated by earthquake or volcano occurring on the ocean floor is called tsunami. T is silent, basically. Tsunami is a Japanese word which means harbor waves. Okay. And Japan was recently, not recently technically, yeah, but much of a recent case, was affected by a tsunami. Now, what happens in tsunami? Buildings and other constructions are destroyed because the waves are really high. And if there is a building and there is a high wave coming, they are immediately destroyed because the waves are really, really powerful. Okay. There is a large-scale loss of life and financial loss. Okay. Three boats and ships near the coast get damaged. Remember, everything can be explained if you take the destructive power of water into account. As much as I can explain, but once you see the video of what is an actual tsunami, it is actually very, very powerful. Okay. Trees get uprooted. Landslides take place on a large scale. Because again, when trees are there, this happens if there are mountain is very near to sea. Okay, what happens is, as the trees get uprooted, there is nothing to hold the soil and landslide take place. Fifth, changes take place in the original land near the coast, giving rise to swamps. What happens is, when this ton of salt water comes on land, this negatively impacts all the water sources. So basically they start to become a bit salty, like salt water. This is what is swamp. Sixth, traffic obstructions arise because there's everything blocking it. Seventh, the business or industry related to the sea are adversely affected and normal day-to-day life is disrupted. This is naturally because it makes sense, because if there is tsunami, the waves are too high, the sea is not calm, and if sea is not calm, everything is destroyed. Eighth, large-scale damage is caused to harbors. Yes, harbors. Because harbors are the first contact where the tsunami comes. So harbors feel the impact of tsunami in the worst possible way, and they are actually damaged. So what is a precautionary measure? That what we do is, it's possible to predict the tsunami. Okay, warning of danger is issued to the people in the coastal areas. For this purpose, a geostationary satellite is used. Now what we have is storms. So now what we know, we already know how storms are formed and what are their effects. Now thing is, how to keep ourselves safe. Okay, now in order to do that, regularly cut down trees or branches that are likely to fall and cause damage. Because suppose that's a tree and the branch, it's near to a home, you cut it and it will first break open the windows and the doors. Okay. Two, if you're outside, take shelter in a safe place. During a storm, staying outside is not recommended. Go inside immediately. Three, if you're away from home, inform your close friends and relatives about your exact location, so that what happens after the storm is that mobile towers are often disrupted. So it's better to call them before the damage starts to happen. Fourth, at home, shut the valves of gas regulator and turn off the electricity supply. Okay, the gas regulators, because what happens if the gas is on, then okay, I can't say why, but yeah, what happens is sometimes these gas regulators, they have the gas which is most dangerous, and for any reason, if this valve is left on, they will the first one to catch fire. Turn off electricity supply, because the storm brings with it rain, and water and electricity are the most dangerous things ever. Okay, fifth, make telephone calls to warn your relatives and friends about the probable danger. Tell them to go to a safer place. Okay, sixth, give temporary shelter to people who are far from their home. Okay, you can learn about the UNDP in the National Situations Headline. And 13th October is the International Day for Disaster Reduction. I think everything is fine. Okay, thank you.